Yesterday we had an item about antidepressants and their possible role in suicide, and this triggered an enormous amount of interest from listeners, and I've got with me two people are deeply interested in the subject, Phil McGillivon, who's a journalist and author and ex-psychiatric social worker, and Patricia Casey, actually it has, it happens, not relevant to this, a neighbour of mine, a professor of psychiatry at UCD and Mater Hospital, and columnist, also a colleague of mine, in the Irish Independent. We'll go to Phil first, because I was speaking to Phil initially this morning, and he was telling me about his concerns about the role of antidepressants in suicide. Phil, just give us, in broad brushstrokes, your understanding of the situation.
Well, it's not my understanding comes from the research, very established research, that these antidepressants, and it's the new generation of antidepressants. You'll hear the term SSRI stated, which is a selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor. It's basically what those drugs do to your brain chemistry to affect your emotional state. Is that they'll be better known by some of their trade names like Prozac and Paxil and Seroxat, and that these, and it's on the jar, as it were, it's on the box, is that these drugs can cause suicidal thoughts and suicidal activity. There has been much criticism of the manufacturers by academics, some of them like the Professor Casey, a psychiatrist, people like Peter Breggin and Professor Healy over in the UK, that these drugs should be far more controlled in their prescription than they currently are, as the Sunday Tribune proved with their journalist just going in and pretending to be slightly depressed to any GP in Dublin. Five out of six, she walked out with a prescription for an SSRI.
Phil, there are two levels here of inquiry or concern. One is the freedom with which this drug is prescribed, and the other is the side effects of the drug. You say that on the package there's a warning, but you know how many people who are feeling depressed are going to pay much attention to a health warning on the package if the warning isn't reinforced massively by the person who's prescribing it.
My experience as a psychiatric social worker in Scotland in the 90s was that people weren't aware of any of the side effects. One of the main side effects of an SSRI, apart from suicidal thoughts, if that wasn't bad enough, is it can be fairly rapid weight gain quite quickly after going on them. And of course, if you put weight on, you could become depressed. You could become sad about your physical state. Is that I was pleased to see that the Scottish Government in 2004 brought in, and this is a connected thing, the ease with which these can be prescribed from a GP, not a specialist in mental health like Professor Casey, just a common or garden GP can give you prescriptions for these very dangerous drugs, is the relationship between the medical profession and pharmaceutical companies. In Scotland now, it is the law. It's not a voluntary guideline like they've had in America for 20 years. It's the law in Scotland that prescribing medics have to put on public record their relationship with different drug companies.
Yes, and in the case in Ireland, and I have no idea of the legal status of that, and Patricia can tell us this, that drugs companies regularly give hospitality to doctors who have weekends away in big castles and doctors' families. And the quid pro quo for their attendance at dinner and drinks and so on is a one-hour lecture.
Kevin, there is a movement that Professor Casey may be aware of in medicine. It's medics and medical students, and it's called the No Free Lunch Movement. And they sign the pledge. They try to get them in training when they're medical students, but also qualified medics, that they will sign up for no free lunch, that they will take nothing. None of these so-called conferences that you've alluded to, which are in effect holidays.
Yes, they are.
Often these deeply clinically interesting conferences happen during the ski season in places like Clusters and Verbier, all expenses paid. All the way down, they even say, even if you start to take pens and pads and things like that, you're being pulled into a relationship. There's a fiduciary relationship between a medic and the patient. You go in to see your doctor, you have to believe that your doctor is on your side, not on the side of the people who are providing him with a free holiday.
Okay, Phil, don't go away. I want you to go, I want to come back to you. Patricia Casey, tell me your response to what you've just been hearing.
Good evening, Kevin, and good evening, Phil. Phil has covered a lot there. Firstly, Phil alluded to the Tribune on Sunday. My position was completely misrepresented by the Tribune.
I'm not even aware of what they said to you, that's an issue you might take up with the Tribune. But it
refers to something that Phil said, which is about antidepressants and suicidality, and he has seemed to imply that I was concurring with somebody else who commented on the Tribune.
So what is your actual position on
that
this?
These antidepressants caused suicide, and I did not say that, and I do not believe that.
Okay, so good. Let's clarify your position then.
About these antidepressants.
Sorry,
and
what is
the warning is this, that in the early stages of treatment, they can cause suicidal thoughts in a small proportion of people, and people have to therefore be on the lookout for that. But once they have taken effect, they do not worsen suicidality. They actually reduce the risk of suicide. So the relationship between medication and these antidepressants and suicidality is a much more complex one than Phil is presenting.
Okay, now I gave Phil a fair run. We'll go back to Phil in a moment, but the audience, and that audience includes me, needs to know in how emphatic you are and with what evidence you may present to justify your argument that suicidality is not increased by taking antidepressants.
There have been a number of meta-analyses. They are studies that combine all of the studies that have been done. So they combine maybe 10 or 12 studies and reanalyze the data as a total. And none of those have found that there is an increase in suicide in people taking the SSRI antidepressants. In the NICE guidelines in Britain, NICE is an acronym for the National Institute of Clinical Excellence, and it was established by Tony Blair about 10 years ago. And it has specified the treatments for a number of conditions, not just psychiatric conditions. And the SSRI antidepressants are the first line of treatment that are recommended for those with depression. Now, I do concur with Phil, though, to the extent that antidepressants are given out far too easily. I completely agree with that. That's not the fault of the GPs, though. That is because the criteria by which we diagnose depression are so low that, you know, almost anybody could have depression. If you were bereaved, you could be classed as having a depressive illness.
Patricia, can I ask you here?
And I actually do not agree with that. I think that is disgraceful. And I've actually written in the scientific literature on that.
Patricia.
So I think that is a huge issue, that people are getting antidepressants who don't need them.
Okay, Patricia, let me ask you this question.
Patricia,
I need to ask you a question here.
Depressive illness, I would have no difficulty in taking antidepressants. I would ask for them. If I developed a full-blown depression, you know, not just the kind of unhappiness that we're talking about, you know, in which some people are prescribed them, but a full-blown depressive illness with early morning wakening, suicidal plans, gross weight loss, I would have no hesitation in taking antidepressants.
Tricia, can I ask you, you said the criteria are set too low. Who sets the criteria?
The criteria were set by the American Psychiatric Association.
But we don't have to attend.
The criteria fell apart about 20 years ago.
But we're capable of.
The Americans decided that instead of talking about reactive and endogenous depression, as we had done before that, and everybody knew what endogenous depression was, that it was a very serious illness in which people became physically and mentally slowed up, lost weight, and committed suicide, they decided to abandon that term. And anybody who was depressed, whether there was a trigger or not, were said to have this new condition called major depression. And all you need to be classified as having major depression are 5 symptoms for 2 weeks.
Okay,
Phil,
just go back to you. Patricia differs with you on the issue of the consequent consequences of taking antidepressants. She says that the evidence is that people are not more inclined to commit suicide after taking antidepressant drugs.
Well, perhaps she would comment on why the Food and Drug Administration in America in March 22nd, 2004 issued a public health advisory cautioning about the risk associated with SSRIs, and I quote, that they could bring about drug-induced suicide and violence.
That has since been altered, and the evidence now, because there have been more studies since then, that was on foot of some work done on Paxil, but other studies have since shown that while they do increase suicidal thoughts, they do not increase suicidal behaviour, except in those under the age of 18.
Okay, now, Phil, you were talking to me before we came on air about cases not of so much of suicide but of violence which might have resulted in suicide of the culprit, but directly associated with the consumption of antidepressant drugs.
Well, one of the ones I'm thinking of is Prozac. There's the case of Joseph Wesbecker, 1989, who only 2 weeks on Prozac came into his employment. He had no history of behaving like this before, obviously, and he murdered 7 people and wounded 12, then killed himself. Now, the fact that he was on Prozac for 2 weeks, which is the trade name for the SSRI fluoxetine made by Eli Lilly, was brought up in court, and it was later found that the maker of Prozac, Eli Lilly, had settled with the relatives of the people who had been killed and wounded out of court. Professor Casey mentioned Paxil. Now, that particular drug made by Smith GlaxoKline, they have been taken to task by the Food and Drug Administration because the scientific or clinical evidence they presented about the minor risk of suicidal thoughts, suicidal behaviour, was the way they had presented it, and this is the Food and Drug Administration said, the way they presented the data was scientifically illegitimate, right? So, and the other thing that comes to this is, very recently there's a study at Hull University in February 2008 by Professor Irving Kirch, a psychologist, that found, with the exception of a small group of very seriously depressed patients, that the effect of these very dangerous drugs, and we know they can be dangerous, and even if we park the suicidal thoughts for a second, you look at things like weight gain and constipation and all these things, is that when they put an analysis beside a control group that took a placebo, there was no difference. And what Professor Kirch says, this means that depressed people can improve without chemical treatments.
Patricia, there's allegation made against the case you're presenting. What argument would you have to
firstly, I want to say I'm surprised that Phil is talking about weight gain, because the SSRI antidepressants actually generally cause weight loss. Mm. And because they cause weight loss, they're actually used in people with bulimia nervosa, who often gain weight because of their binge eating. So the idea that they cause depression and weight gain, I'm not quite sure where that's coming from. I think it may be some of the other antidepressants do that, but not the SSRIs generally. Now, in relation to the Hull study, the Hull study found that people with severe depression benefited from antidepressants. They found that people with mild to moderate mild to moderate didn't benefit. They were the same. They had the same effect as those on placebo. Now, I have absolutely no difficulty with people with so-called mild depression not receiving antidepressants. I do not prescribe an antidepressant for mild depression. But the moderate depression thing still boils down to the bar that is set. And the bar is set very low. In order to have moderate depression, you have to have 5 symptoms for 2 weeks. So it doesn't surprise me that people classified as having moderate depression do not show any superior response to antidepressants over placebo. That doesn't surprise me in the least. But, you know, these are people that are usually treated by GPs. The people that we see in our outpatient clinics generally have much more severe depression than that, and certainly, in my opinion, need and benefit from antidepressants. But the problem, as I said, is
wind up here now.
How you define depression, and it is defined so widely now. No longer do we look even at the symptom patterns as we used to in the past. For example, a typical a symptom would have been early morning wakening and feeling worse in the morning. Those symptoms have all been jettisoned in favour of a very simple tick box approach of, you know, 5 symptoms for 2 weeks. And if you have that, you will have moderate depression or major depression. The two terms are used interchangeably, and you will get put on an antidepressant. And
I
would concur with Phil on that. I don't have a problem about that.
Okay, listen, Phil, we'll be talking to you again about this. And Patricia, thanks very much.